Presidential candidate Peter Obi falsely accused of belonging to a separatist group. A fake video of Elon Musk endorsing him.
With regards to his works on Peter Obi campaign, someone I have great respect for and will be working with him in future by next year.
A photo altered to make candidate Bola Tinubu look much older. Viral posts falsely suggesting that candidate Atiku Abubakar has fallen ill. Millions of Nigerians are trying to decide who to vote for in the next general election. They are up against a flood of false political information on social media, and we've discovered that much of it is paid for. Twitter is probably the most influential platform in this election. You might think people are sharing their own beliefs. But the BBC has spoken to multiple people who claim that influencers are being paid by political parties to deliberately spread false information on social media. They're not disclosing they're being paid to show support, making it hard for users to grasp their real intentions. Two insiders from two of Nigeria's political parties have told the BBC's disinformation team what's really going on, revealing secrets about how these influence operations work. We've agreed to protect their identity, so we've changed their names and used actors to reconstruct their interviews. Yemi is a prominent strategist, and Godia, a politician.
We recruit people directly on social media and create accounts with which we do this. When recruiting, we look at people in the space who have a voice. They don't necessarily have to be talking about politics.
Payments to influencers is a grey area. We avoid banks to avoid scrutiny. We don't have a budget for this, and we have people who move this money around. We have people look away in airports to allow someone move this cash around. We have paid an influencer up to 20 million naira for delivering a certain result. I think that's the highest I have seen where someone was paid for being an influencer.
Yemi also mentioned paying an influencer up to 20 million naira. That's around $45,000. Under Nigerian law, it isn't illegal for political parties to hire social media influencers, but it is illegal to spread disinformation, and it goes against Twitter's policy. Twitter's rules also state people must disclose when they're being paid to promote content, so their followers can make informed decisions about what they are seeing. We've asked Nigeria's main political parties, APC, PDP, and Labour Party, about the whistleblowers' allegations. They did not reply to our request for comment. But using influencers to spread propaganda is a well-known strategy inside the political world.
Anybody who denies it, anybody who says that there isn't a dark, shadowy aspect of political influencing using social media platforms will not be telling the truth.
Godia is a politician who knows all about the dirty tactics used to persuade people.
We use images that may not even be relevant to the story we're trying to spin. We can take pictures from East Africa in the 90s, in war zones, and attach it to a tweet about how my ethnic group is being killed. When people get emotional, they like, they retweet, it gets traction.
The tweets are posted by influencers, but she says their messages are carefully controlled by strategists from political parties.
We have situation rooms where there are people whose job it is to monitor how well a narrative is doing. They have a roster of what to post every day of the week. They have targets.
The insiders we spoke to told us how influencers are paid to spread false information. We can't show the exact campaigns they worked on to protect their identities. But there are hundreds of other confirmed cases of false information about Nigerian politics going viral on Twitter. But even when there's no evidence of money changing hands, political disinformation shapes conversations on Nigerian Twitter. It could be false claims about a presidential candidate supporting extrajudicial killings, unsubstantiated rumors about a candidate's poor health, or claims that a candidate is stepping down when they are not. In August, influencers promoted without evidence the claim that presidential candidate Peter Obi from the Labour Party was linked to and following orders from the Indigenous People of Biafra, IPOB, a designated terror group. His party denies this. One of the people pushing that narrative was Rino Omukri, who was special assistant to former President Goodluck Jonathan from the opposition party PDP, to his more than 2 million followers. When approached for a comment, Rino Omukri said he stands by his accusations, but insists he has not been paid by the People's Democratic Party to campaign on their behalf. This post also went viral. It claims to show Mr. Obi's son at an IPOB protest in Europe, standing on the Nigerian flag, and was shared by a prominent social media strategist and political opponent of Mr. Obi from the ruling APC. But the man in the photo is not Peter Obi's son. When we reached out to Mr. Akinsola Akin to comment on his post, he did not respond. In July, more false political claims made by influencers associating Kashim Shettima, a candidate for vice president, with members of the Islamist militant group Boko Haram, were widely shared. This tweet claims to show Mr. Shettima sharing a meal with Boko Haram members, but a reverse image search showed that the picture was first used in news reports in 2017 of a meeting between him and Fulani parents when he was governor of Borno State. We do not have evidence that these specific examples involved payment of any kind, but we've spoken to multiple influencers independently who have confirmed to us that there's a widespread practice of payment in exchange for false political posts. Some admitted that they themselves have received payment from political parties, but wouldn't provide evidence for fear of self-incrimination. One influencer we spoke to told us he was currently being paid by a political party to post made-up stories about rival politicians. Separately, Rabi Ibiora, an influencer known for supporting the ruling APC, told us he was wooed by a major opposition party to influence for its presidential candidate and to stop promoting the APC's candidate on social media. He said he did not receive gifts of any kind to change sides. However, in this Facebook post, he said he received a car and money from the opposition party in exchange for his support on social media. We asked him again about it, and he did not respond to our messages. Despite these issues, there are those who argue social media has had a positive effect on political debate.
The fundamental difference between this space and the TV and the newspapers is that it's far more democratized. Nobody needs to write somebody to share their opinion. Nobody needs to write somebody to post it on Medium, post it on their blog, post it on their YouTube page. And that's better. That's good for the democracy.
But the false messages spread by influencers tend to spill offline.
There is a very blurred line between the online and the offline in the Nigerian context. There, people, what is discussed online form topic for discussion in most morning shows on television. In markets, homes, and even a union or association meeting.
Godia told us this is even part of a deliberate strategy.
We also have this tactic that's new. We go to places where people hang out, like beer parlors, meshai joints, and we just kind of throw in a topic of discussion there. And we try to convince everybody there about our own narrative. And people don't suspect a thing. They think it's just a citizen just like them.
Godia does not regret the strategy employed, but fears it could cause havoc.
I don't see it as an issue of right and wrong. I'm very pragmatic about it. It's a game. Somebody has to win, and God help me, I will not be on the losing side. What gives me concern really is the fact that people are willing to set this country on fire. I mean, literally, people could die. We could go into a civil war. This country is fractured as it is already, and nobody seems to care. People just want to win the election.
We also asked Yemi how she feels about her work. She refused, however, to take any personal responsibility for what the hired influencers do. But some posts with false information have made it into news blogs and radio programs, becoming real conversations on the streets of Nigeria.
It's a form of electoral interference also, because at the end of every election, it is very difficult to sort fact from fiction.
Twitter's office in Ghana was closed and nearly all of its staff was fired after Elon Musk's takeover of the company, raising concerns there might be an increase of misinformation on the platform. In response to our findings, Twitter has taken down some of the accounts we reported, and it said it has a responsibility to protect electoral conversation from interference and manipulation, as well as the spread of false information. But as Nigerians go to the polls, they may be questioning how to trust the political information they are getting without knowing who is really behind it.